See, when you deal with the variable force, okay, one very common variable force is the spring force. Fine. So it will be very common to find the work done due to the spring force later on. Fine. So since we'll be dealing with the spring force or the work done by the spring force multiple times, so let us just derive the expression for work done by the spring force, and then we can directly use the expression for work done by the spring force. Okay. So we are trying to derive the expression for a very common type of variable force, which is the spring force. Write down work done by spring force, okay, or work done by spring. All right, so let us say that there is a spring with a spring constant K. Spring constant is K. Fine. And initially, the spring was extended from its natural position. It was extended by a value of x1. And finally, it got extended to x2. Fine. So the spring is getting extended from x1 to x2. You need to find the work done by the spring when this process happens. Okay. Try to do it. Spend some time. It's a variable force, right? And you know that the force because of the spring will be K times X. Okay. And this force direction is opposite to the direction of change in X. Sorry, the force itself depends on change in X. So force is K delta X. You can put a minus sign like this. So force is equal to minus of K times X. Fine. Now, work done, if you suppose displace this spring by dx, okay, you further extend it by dx. So the displacement will be opposite to the direction of the spring force, right? So you can write the work done as minus of kx dx. Fine. Where x is the change, or x is the so to say from the natural length, how much it has deviated, that is x. Okay, so if the deviation increases by dx further, then the work done will be kx dx, and we are talking about a negative work done by the spring here, because the force of spring when your displacement is this direction will be in opposite direction because the spring is already extended. Fine. So this is the small amount of work done. Total work done will be an integral of this, and K is a constant. Fine. If K is not a constant, it will not come out of integral. So we can make a numerical in which K also depends on X. Fine. But right now we'll take a generic case. K is a constant. Let's say its extension goes from x1 to x2, right? So this will be equal to minus of k by 2 x2 square minus x1 square. All right. So the work done, okay, Sukirt is asking why it is negative. Okay, so we are taking a case in which the spring is extended already, fine, and you are further extending it, right? So when spring is extended, this side, the spring will apply force in that side, and you're further extending that side. So force will continue to act in backside. So there is 180 degree between force and the displacement. So that is why it is negative. Okay. So this will come out to be half of kx1 square minus half of kx2 square. Fine. So this is the work done by the spring. All right. Now you're going to see something which is very unique to the spring. Suppose initially, spring was compressed. Fine. It was compressed by x1, right? And then you are extending it. Now it is extended by x2, right? So compared to natural length, the spring initially was in compressed state. And compared to natural length, spring now has an extension of x2. Okay, so in this process, when you go from point one to point two, now what is the work done by the spring? Can you try it your own? Is the compression equal to extension? See, compression is right now x1 and extension is later on x2. Okay, Bharat, that is not correct. Sukirt, no. No, Sukirt. Others, please try it our own. Yes, Bharat, it will come out to be same. The work done by this spring is same. Okay, let us see how we can do this particular case. See, right now the spring is compressed. It is compressed by x1. Let us say that it goes to natural length. This is step number one to step number two. From compression, it goes to the natural length and then it gets extended. Fine. So this is, this dotted line is natural length. So this is x1 and that is x2, right? Okay, now from 1 to 2, the work done is positive because the spring will try to push in this direction and the displacement is also in that direction. So work done will be positive from 1 to 2. So let us say work done is w here and w2 there. So total work done will be W1 plus W2. Fine. So just try to find out work done W1 and W2 separately. So W1 work done will be integral of Kx dx. The limits of x will be from x1 to 0. Okay. It will minus will come outside. It net net it should come out to be a positive thing, all right, because the force is always on the right hand side and displacement is also on the right hand side. Okay, okay, fine. So this is equal to half of kx1 square, all right. Now W2 is what? W2 is minus of kx dx. Now x is going from 0 to x2. You'll get here as minus of half kx2 square. Fine. So total work then will be sum of this plus that. So w will be equal to w1 plus w2. This will be equal to half kx1 square minus half of square. Fine. So it does not matter whether it is compression or extension. Fine. So if initial, write down, if initially compression or any of it, if it is x1 and finally compression or extension, it doesn't matter. If it is x2, then the work done, then the work done by the spring will be half kx1 square minus half kx2 square. Fine. It doesn't matter whether x1 is compression or extension, or x2 is compression or extension. Fine. All of you understood this? Work done by the spring. Any doubt? Anything? Please type in yes or no. No, it did not freeze, Niranjan. No doubts. Okay, so now I think only 17 people are there. So we'll focus on problem solving. Okay, so let us take up questions now. But that doesn't mean that problem solving is lesser importance. This is actually more important than the concepts. Assume there is a force. See, you see that at times the problems from this chapter can be solved by applying concepts from the new chapter. Okay, so you can solve the question in two different ways. But the thumb rule is, you should first try to solve using concept from this chapter, because you are dealing with scalars. And second, whenever they talk about finding velocity, okay, so try to use work energy theorem. Okay, do not find acceleration and then from acceleration you find the final velocity. So suppose there is a force of 100 Newton applied here. This is a block of 1 kg mass. Okay. Initially, its velocity was 1 meter per second. You need to find out the final velocity when this block got displaced by a distance of 2 meters. All of you clear about it? If you have any doubts, please type in or start doing it. Okay, there is a block. It has initial velocity of 1 meter per second. You are applying 100 Newton horizontally. Fine. Coefficient of friction is 0.1 between the block and the ground. All right. When this block moves by 2 meters, what is the final velocity of this block? Use work energy theorem. Okay. Don't use Newton's laws of motion concept to solve this, because we are just learning how to apply work energy theorem. Root of 395, that's what Niranjan also got. Okay, so see here, basically you need to find total work done on this 1 kg block. Work done by 100 Newton force, work done by friction, work done by gravity, and work done by normal force. All these work done, when you add up, will be equal to change in kinetic energy. That is half m into v square minus half m into u square. I hope you all have got this particular thing. Work done by the 100 Newton force is what? 100 into 2. Okay. Work done by friction is what? First of all, we have to find friction force, which is mu times normal reaction. Normal reaction is what? Mg, right? So which is 1 into 10, so 10 newtons is Mg. So mu into 10 is 1 newton. Okay, so friction force is 1 newton, and good thing is we know the direction, which is opposite to the displacement. Minus 1 into 2 is a work done by friction, work done by gravity is 0, and work done by normal direction is 0, because both of them make 90 degree with the displacement. Okay, this is equal to half m is 1, so v square minus half m is 1, u is 1, so this is just half. Okay, so v square by 2 minus half is equal to 200 minus 2, 200 minus 2, 198. Okay, so v square is equal to 198 into 2 plus 1. Fine. So this is 397 v square. So v is equal to under root of 397. Fine. Okay, we'll take up one more question before closing this session. Any doubts on this message? Any doubts on whatever we have done just now? We have simply applied work energy theorem. Any doubts? Okay, guys. So let us move to next question. I'll take up a JEE advanced level question. See, we have learned everything that will take you, that will take to answer any question from this chapter. Okay, although the definition of potential energy is something which we haven't done yet, but then if you apply work energy theorem, you can solve almost every question. Okay, so I'll just find out a question from previous year. This thing, I think online session like this is a lot more efficient than the physical class. Otherwise, you guys talk so much, I waste my energy in just keeping you quiet. You can type in your feedback on whatever I just said. So what I will do here is that I'll just discuss with you the scenario initially, and then you have to solve it yourself. This is M and that is capital M. By the way, we have derived work energy theorem for a particular Shushant, I doubt. Anyways. So we have discussed work energy theorem, but that work energy theorem is applicable for a single mass right now. Okay, so work done on mass 1, change in kinetic energy of mass 1, right? So this is mass m1's. Okay, wait. So this is for mass 1, K1 minus K2. Okay, I am talking about mass 1. This is M1, M1. Okay, and suppose there are two masses in a system, like in this particular scenario, two masses are there. Then work done on the second mass will be equal to change in kinetic energy for the second mass. I am writing it in a wrong way. Let me correct it. Change is always K2 minus K1. Okay, work done work done on the second mass is, focus on the question, K2 for mass 2 minus, right now I'm discussing the concept, okay, I'll describe the question a little bit later, K1 M2. Fine. So these are the two work done on two different masses. If you add up these two work done, if you add basically two equations, you'll get here K2 for mass 1 plus K2 for mass 2 minus K1 for mass 1 plus K1 for mass 2. Okay, now basically there will be some internal force between mass 1 and mass 2. Right now the internal force is tension between capital M and small m. Fine. So when you add up the work done separately like this, work done by the internal force cancels out. So this will be only, this is work done by external forces. So external force is what? Mg is the external force over here. Alright. So total work done on the system. Okay. It is change in kinetic energy of the total system. The system may have multiple masses. So change in the final kinetic energy of mass M1 plus final kinetic energy of mass M2 and so on minus, you know, initial kinetic energy of mass M1, initial kinetic energy of mass M2. So we just modified work energy theorem so that we can apply it for a system which has multiple masses. Okay. Now let us see what this question is about. Bharat is in a hurry. Focus on the concept. Okay. Anyways, a string with one end fixed on the rigid wall. So this end is fixed on the rigid wall, passes over the fixed frictionless pulley. So this is a fixed pulley through which this string is passing. And this distance is 2 meters. Okay. Capital M has a mass of 2 kgs. Small m has a mass of 0.5 kgs. All right. Now the string is horizontal. That capital M, this string is horizontal. Fine. This one from here till here, the string is horizontal. Okay. And it is vertical from here till here. So this string is vertical. That string is horizontal. Okay. You need to find out what will be the speed. What will be the speed with which capital M will hit the wall when you release the small m. What will happen? This is small m will start moving upwards. Okay. When this small m starts moving upward, since the capital M is heavier, the heavier mass tries to come down, okay, and when it comes down, it will try to move in a circle like this, and the entire string, Ajay, you guys try please first, then we'll discuss the solution. Try it your own. Does it have friction, Advait? Where you see friction can be? And there is no contact surface. Pulley is frictionless, which is your usual case. There is no surface contact. So there is no question of friction. No, Sukhi, the string is not cut. See that this small m is very light. So it automatically, this capital M will go down. And when capital M goes down, this will move up. This capital M is hanging in air right now. Are you guys clear about the question? Type in yes or no. Now try solving it. This came in, you know, very, very long back when you guys, not even born, 1985. I was 2 years old. That's a very valid question. This distance, the distance of capital M from the wall is 1 meter. Start solving the question and you forget what is asked. Huh? We have to find with what velocity capital M hits the wall. Okay. With what velocity capital M hits the wall? You just write equations, don't need to solve it, and just message that you have written the equation. Then I'll write my equations. You can compare. Message done when you're done with writing the equations. Oh, somebody got the answer. Velocity root of 2. Oh, Niranjan, I've read it. Answer is 3.29 meter per second. Is that what you guys are getting? 3.29. 5 root 5 is like, you can say 10. So root 10 is what? Yeah, Sukirt, close to that. That's correct. Okay, let us analyze the scenario. I'll just analyze the scenario and see what it is. When this block moves, how it will move? It will move in a circle. So it will complete a quarter circle and hit here. Getting it? So when it hits here, the string becomes like this, isn't it? So now see what is happening. This block comes down. Okay, this block comes down and this block moves up. Suppose this is x, the distance it moves up. I need to find out the distance. Why? Because I need to find out the work done by gravity. And for that, I need to know what is the displacement, right? So this is clear. How much capital M moves along the direction of gravity? This is 1 meter only, because the distance of capital M from this is 1 meter, right? I need to find out what is X, all right? So for that, I need to first know what is this length. This length is root over 2 square plus 1 square, which is under root 5. Fine. So initially, that same length was 1 meter. And now it has stretched. This distance, 1 meter, got stretched to root 5. Right? So the extra distance, that is root 5 minus 1, this must have been coming from this end. Fine. So this is the value of X. All right. Now gravity is doing work on capital M as well as on small M. All right. So work done by the gravity on capital M will be mg into what? Into 1. All right, because that is the displacement of capital M along the direction of gravity. Fine. Work done by the gravity on small M. This is what? Now minus sign will come because gravity is acting down, but this is small M is going up. By what distance? By X. Right? So this will be small m g into root 5 minus 1. All right, there is no other external force. Fine. Or you can say that this tension, might you may feel it is external force, okay, which is correct also, but then since we are saying that it is moving in a circle, tension always remains perpendicular to the displacement, so work done by this tension will be 0. Okay, so total work done in the system will be work done by the gravity on capital M plus work done by the gravity on small m, right? This total work done will be equal to change in kinetic energy. So if initial velocity was zero and final velocity is v1 and v2, you can say that kinetic energy is half small m into v1 square plus half capital M into v2 square, where v1 is the velocity of small m and v2 is the velocity of capital M. All right. Now we need to find a relation between velocity of capital M and velocity of small m. All right. Now, in order to find the relation between the velocities, I need to use constraint relation here, that the string is fixed length. Fine. So string is of fixed length. Hence, along the string, relative velocity should be zero. If along the string, if there is any relative velocity, it means that the length of the string is changing. Fine. So if the relative velocity along the string is zero, then what will be the scenario? So for small m, we are saying v1 is a velocity. Okay. And for capital M, we are saying velocity is horizontal because it is moving in a circle. Fine. So after quarter circle, it will try to hit the wall horizontally. Fine. So if this is the angle theta, fine, and this is the velocity, let us say this is v2, is theta, I can say that v2 cos theta is the velocity component along the direction of string. Okay, this should be equal to v1. All right, and what is cos theta? You have a nice right angle triangle here, for which cos theta is 2/√5. Fine. Is this how you guys have done it? Krishna, Sukir, those who got the correct answer, is this how you have done this? Yes or no? Is this how you guys have done it? Okay. Anyways, hope you have learned a few concepts from this particular question. So in JEE Advanced, questions like these you can expect. All right. So today was just a basic session on introduction to work and energy. All right. So next class, probably, our focus will be more on problem solving. Okay. We'll start with the basic level of problems and then we'll build on it. And we'll also introduce something which is called potential energy. Okay. So we'll introduce potential energy and we'll see that how we can use potential energy in problem solving also. Okay. At times, you know, in question itself, it will be written that potential energy is this much. So you cannot avoid potential energy at times. All right. Otherwise, if there is an open-ended question like this, where there's no mention of using potential energy, you can solve this particular question without using gravitational potential energy formula. Okay. Because you have work energy theorem, which is more generic. All right. So thanks for joining in. And that's it for today's class. And I hope you have enjoyed today's online session. The homework for this class is you have to finish objective 1 from HC Verma. At times you'll see some questions for which we haven't done theory yet, but that's okay. You try to do it still, and then you have to solve at least 30 questions from exercise 1. Okay, so that is the homework for next class, and come with all of your doubts and we'll discuss it first, and then we'll continue with the session. Okay, thank you.